Good afternoon, everyone. I was saying that result has come. So I think result is in the process. Process mein hai na abhi result. Aa gaya pura ho gaya. So kya result kya hai usme? BJP ko kitna mila hai? EVM kharab hai. Acha. EVM machine wahan par hai. Okay. Anyway, let's start with the topic there. Fixing can also be there. Because on the way, all this celebration was there. jo result aaya hoga uska, they were. So anyway, in that case, that is the election result there. Okay, last time I was discussing about nuclear technology, nuclear reactors. Okay, whatever you learn today's class, that will also be linked with PT365, because today in PT365, I will be discussing about biotechnology and healthcare. Those two topics will come, and based on concept we will learn in the classroom, biotechnology techniques and tools. But there I will be discussing a current aspect on biotechnology. So I will be able to link with today's class with the PT365. Now let's look into second thing. See, besides the nuclear reactors, what comes the next one is the nuclear fuel cycle. Right? Now another concept which comes here in nuclear technology is to understand nuclear fuel cycle. Now let me give the main points first one. See, nuclear fuel cycle, it is based on processes required for power generation. When nuclear power is generated, or atomic energy, nuclear power generated, it requires number of processes and operations. That collectively is called as nuclear fuel cycle. So it includes all those kind of processes required here for power generation. Right. Now what is the next thing here? It has two ends. Two parts are there. Front end and back end. And it will all become clear when I explain every aspect. You'll understand every aspect, all this part of it. Front end of the cycle processes include, I'm writing the name of the processes that include following operations: survey and exploration, survey and exploration of uranium or thorium, wherever the reserves are there. Then next comes here, mining and milling, mining operation, and then purifying the ore, milling operation. Third operation which comes in front end cycle, that includes enrichment facilities. That includes the enrichment facility there. Right. So enrichment technology is required there, enrichment. And there is a fourth one which I'm writing here, fabrication. It will become all clear. Let me just first write the things there. So front end cycle of nuclear fuel cycle includes the following processes: survey and exploration of minerals, uranium or thorium, mining of such minerals, and then purifying the ore, converting the ore into suitable form, which can be put in a nuclear reactor. So that includes enrichment process and fabrication. This is called front end of the cycle. Whereas back end of the cycle, I'll write here, on the back end of the cycle, it requires following operations. So back end cycle includes, it includes there following processes. One is that power generation. So power generation will be done in the nuclear reactors, in nuclear parks. Then what comes the next one? What is called, there's a process called reprocessing. Reprocessing of spent fuel, whatever has been used up in the nuclear reactor, and what was left over, spent fuel. Reprocessing facility is required. And what comes here, very important process, what I'm writing here, nuclear waste management. Nuclear waste management. Right, nuclear waste management. So nuclear waste management is again important step required there, because uranium or thorium or plutonium, whatever we talk about, is all very radioactive. It cannot be dumped outside in air and or ground. It has to be converted into a non-hazardous form and should not go to the environment. So there comes a technology which can help in nuclear waste management. So this whole process, what I've written here, survey and exploration, mining and milling, enrichment and fabrication, then power generation nuclear reactors in nuclear parks, reprocessing of spent fuel and nuclear waste management, that collectively is called nuclear fuel cycle. So when you read newspaper and you come across the term nuclear fuel cycle, this all should come to your mind, right? Now I'll come to that part. For all these processes in India, Department of Atomic Energy, DAE, right, with the support of BARC, Bhabha Atomic Research Center, we have established facilities for that. We have different R&D centers. We have different PSUs, public sector undertakings, which are involved into all this kind of operations. So we have laid infrastructure in the country. Today, India is self-reliant in terms of civilian power generation. Right, we are self-reliant. Right, and it has happened in the past 60 years of efforts. All the efforts done by the government of India. Today, India is said to be nuclear capable country. We have developed technologies for that. Now let me come to every aspect of it. One by one, I'll come to this one. Let me draw the cycle there. So cycle koi aisa nahi hai, ye steps ko collectively kaha jata hai. Uske liye yahan pe word hai. So now let me come to that. So we can understand in the following way. And I'll write the names of the facilities also there. Along with this one, I'll write the names there. Now let's understand. See, first is what? First need of any nuclear power generation is that one need to have fuel. And worldwide, the fuel uses uranium. And uranium is found where? Earth crust, right? Earth crust is part of land also and water also, ocean. There could be there. So what I've written here? I've written that first step what is required is a survey and exploration. So let me just remove this one. Now, when you talk about survey and exploration, we have in our country one very important center, which is located in Hyderabad. I'll write the name of center also there. So let me start the cycle. The first cycle is survey and exploration. Of minerals. Now we have a center, let me use the different color. We have a center called as Atomic Minerals Directorate. We have Atomic Minerals Directorate, and this AMD is located in Hyderabad, which carries out all the exploration of uranium deposits in the country. And earlier we were thinking that India has limited reserve of uranium, but now we have found many places in the country in different states where we have uranium reserve. That uranium reserve is there. So first step comes here, survey and exploration. There is a center called Atomic Minerals Directorate. Right? Now what comes the next? Mining operation. Second step will be mining. Now mining and what I'm writing here, milling operation. This part, for this one, we have a public sector undertaking, a company named Uranium Corporation of India Limited, UCIL, which is located in Jadugura in Jharkhand. Right, because Jadugura, there's a mine, uranium mine is there. So now I'm writing the name of the company. The name of the company is Uranium, Uranium Corporation of India Limited. There's a dedicated company which carries out mining. It is in charge of mining operation. Uranium Corporation of India Limited, which is located in Jadugura. Because currently, whatever the mines we have, our uranium mines are in Jadugura. Jadugura is a part of the Singhbhum district of Jharkhand. Right? So there we have a company called UCIL. So UCIL is tasked with mining part. Now, wherever we mine the uranium, there's a uranium which is taken from earth crust. So what is very important? We require enrichment. What is enrichment? See, natural uranium, let me write here. If we talk about natural uranium, it consists of two types of isotopes. What are isotopes? Same atomic number, but different mass numbers. Two types of isotopes are there. Let me write their names there. See, natural uranium, uranium contains 235 and uranium 238. Right? When we do the mining of ore, uranium ore, so 1 gram of uranium ore will have one part, this one. It will be one part 235 and 139 part 238. That means uranium 238 is more abundant as compared to uranium 235. But for power generation, what we require? Uranium 235. Did you get that? Because nuclear fission, right, fission chain reaction, there's a slow neutron strikes the uranium 235 nucleus, and 235 is broken down into daughter nuclei, barium, krypton, and three more neutrons are generated, which carries out the furthermore nuclear fission. So 235, but actually what is the problem? When we do the mining, we find only one part 235 and rest of the part are 238. So here comes a technology called enrichment. So what we do, we increase the concentration of 235. So next what comes here, third step is there here, is called as enrichment technology or enrichment facility. Now enrichment is done at the place where we do the mining. So today, Jadugudha, from where we do the uranium mining, there we have enrichment facility. Now one method of enrichment of uranium is using ultracentrifugation, you know, centrifuge, you know, high velocity. So in that case, what will happen? Based on the mass, 235 and 238 will get separated. That is what is done there. So what is done here, enrichment? So here enrichment, now I'm writing here, uranium 235 isotope is enriched. Now I'm giving you the percentage also, is enriched to 4%. Now why I have said 4%? Because we need to generate power. We don't want to make a nuclear weapon. Right? If we have to make atom bomb or nuclear weapon, there we require more enrichment. Right? But here, what we need? We need controlled chain reaction. Where? In a reactor, nuclear reactor. Worldwide, enrichment of uranium 235 is just 4-5%. So what I want to say, when we use uranium in the nuclear reactor, it is not only uranium 235, but mixture with 238 also. But 235 will be only 4-5%. Rest of them are 238, which are part of that. Now what comes here? We cannot directly take uranium and put it in the reactor. We cannot do that. We need something called fuel bundle. We have to convert into fuel. So now comes the process called fabrication. So what comes the next step here is the fabrication method. Now what is fabrication? Here, what we do is that uranium oxide, which is a yellow cake. What is done in fabrication? Uranium is converted into oxide. Right, and this is a solid form, yellow in color. What is the popularly called a yellow cake? Oxidized form, right? Then what we do is that we convert it, this is converted into pellets. What is pellet? We solidify it, kind of a round, circular type, a small type pellets. So there is something called pelletization. We convert into a pellets there. And then such kind of pellets, let me draw a diagram, this is like this one. This kind of pellets, right, this pellets, which I've drawn the diagram, is packaged into a cylindrical tube. We put in a cylindrical tube, right, which is called fuel rod, nuclear fuel rod. So now this, what happens, is packaged into cylindrical steel tube is there, which becomes a fuel rod. Then what is done? Number of fuel rods are combined together to form fuel assembly. It may be 50 rods, maybe 100 rods, maybe 200 rods. That depends upon what type of reactor and how much power generation done by the reactor. How much of fuel is required in a reactor. Agar reactor 1000 megawatt ka hai, to jyada fuel chahiye. To wahan fuel bundle jyada hoga, jyada rods honge. Agar 300 megawatt ka hai, kam ka hai, to kam number of rods chahiye. To usko packaging kiya tha. Then what happens here is a fuel bundle is made. Fuel bundle and assembly is made. So you'll find this kind of a fuel bundle assemblies are there. This is made there. And this fuel bundle, the assembly that goes in the core of the reactor, that plays in the reactor core where nuclear reaction takes place. Now for this task, for fabrication, we have a center nuclear fuel complex, Hyderabad. Now for that we have an establishment called as nuclear fuel complex, which is located in Hyderabad. Clear? For exploration we have a Atomic Minerals Directorate. For mining, milling and enrichment we have UCIL, Uranium Corporation of India Limited. For fabrication we have nuclear fuel complex in Hyderabad. Now this fuel bundle which is made there, now this goes to the different nuclear parks, right? So where we have nuclear parks, Trombe, Tarapur, then you know about Kakra Power in Gujarat, Narora in Bulandshahr, UP, then Kaiga in Karnataka, Rawatbhatta in Rajasthan, right, wherever we generate power, nuclear power. So now what comes the next one? Next step which comes here is the power generation. It go to the power reactor, the power generation. Now what will happen? The fuel will be used up in power generation and will generate what called spent fuel, fuel which has been spent. Now there will be number of radionuclei into that. So now what comes? The two process comes, now which I'm writing here. Reprocessing. The next comes here, reprocessing. Now reprocessing, what happens? Let me write the thing here. In the reprocessing, what is done is that unused uranium is separated, because in the reaction all the uranium will not be used up, right? There will be some leftover uranium, so those uranium is taken, separated. Then what we do is that there may be in the spent fuel radioisotopes which can be used in medicine, right? In medicine like cobalt 60, cancer treatment. So we can also recover, what is there? Recovery of radioisotopes. We take out radioisotopes. The radioisotopes are recovered. Now when we use uranium-235 and 238 mixture, so what would happen in that reaction process, plutonium will also be generated. Because what I said, when you talk about this, it's not totally 235, 238 is also there. So some of the 238 may get converted into plutonium. So we can separate the plutonium also. And here recovery radioisotopes and plutonium. So plutonium which is produced there can be also taken out. Whatever is remaining, whatever is left over, will be all toxic radioactive material. So what comes the next one? Nuclear waste. So now let's say unused uranium. So this unused uranium will be again enriched. Again we can fabricate. Again we can use it again. Right? And whatever is left, whatever the remaining thing is there, so that remaining thing will go into what is called as here nuclear waste management. It's called nuclear waste management. Right, nuclear waste management. Now how in India we carry out nuclear waste management? So I'm now giving you the method of nuclear waste management. What we do is that such kind of highly toxic radioactive nuclear waste is first immobilized in a glass or cement, you know, mortar. Jaise ghar banate hain to concrete ye banate hain na, wall wagera, to wahan kya karte hain, cement wagera mix kar diya jata hai. To bark mein kya kiya jata hai, all this nuclear waste is taken and they can be mixed with those kind of silicates and can be made into a kind of a solidified form, a cement kind of matrix. Or what we can do, we can heat the nuclear waste to very high temperature and convert into glass, and just say bangles and glass is made. So within the glass, this nuclear waste, radioactive material is immobilized. It becomes immobilized there. Then what we do? We keep this immobilized waste for 20-30 years. Why we keep for 20-30 years? By that time radioactivity will be lower. And then what we do? We take this kind of waste and dump into the earth. Normally what we prefer? Abandoned mines. Mines which are abandoned, where mining is no more done. So those kind of underground mines, abandoned mines, we can dump the waste. We can put inside the waste. Or we can put into the oceans, seabed and something. Because you cannot keep it in outside in air, because there will be radiations. Radiations will be there. So what is the best way? Put under the earth system, earth crust, right? But again, we have to take care. What we have to take care? If we put under the earth, we have to see that there is no groundwater. Right? There should not be any kind of a thing which can contaminate the soil or water. But again, that will be dangerous. So we take care. There are guidelines for that. Right? There are guidelines for that. So let me come across this. So nuclear waste management. So I'm writing here, nuclear waste management. First, what is done in nuclear waste management? So I'm writing the point here, nuclear waste management. The first one is that, you can write this in note copy. First part is that, spent fuel, this nuclear waste is vitrified. What is done? Nuclear waste is vitrified. I am using the word vitrified, vitrification. Vitrified into cement or glass matrix. They are put into such kind of a matrix, solidified there at very high temperature. Then what happened here? Stored for 20 years. Storage for 20 years. This is what we are doing in the country. Right? And then what comes the third? Then we dumped into deep geological structure. Deep geological structures. I'll read out so that people who are not able to see there, I'll read out. What is given third? This nuclear waste, vitrified waste, after 20 years, they are dumped into deep geological structures. Now this geological structure could be abandoned mines, or that area where you have impervious rocks. Rocks which are impervious, which will not allow the radiation to leak out. Leakage to the environment. So those kind of area. So deep geological structure we... And this responsibility of nuclear waste management has been given to BARC, Bhabha Atomic Research Center. So BARC is responsible for nuclear waste management, this one. Trombe and Tarapur Center, that is responsible for that. So this is what called nuclear fuel cycle. It's very, very important because UPSC has not asked question till yet in this particular topic. Now what is very important here? This is the facilities what we have in the country. If any country develops nuclear fuel cycle facilities, that country will become nuclear capable. The country can use for peaceful purpose, also for nuclear weapon program. Why the nuclear weapon program? We can reprocess and enrich to make nuclear bomb, right? So any country which develops this kind of facilities can be used for both civilian use, power generation, at the same time, nuclear here can be reprocessed like plutonium, or can be enriched and can use for weapon program. So in India, we have both the dual. We have weapon program also there, we have civilian use also there. So Iran, you know the Iran. Iran was trying to build this one. And then you know that Western powers, Western countries, right, along with IAEA and Germany, they came to prevent Iran from developing this fuel cycle. Because there was a threat that if Iran would have developed this kind of cycle processes, then Iran could have gone for nuclear weapons. And that could have been threat to the geopolitics there in the neighboring countries. So that was negotiated by Western countries, P5, you know, permanent five members of Security Council, along with Germany. Then a deal was done with Iran. So many times in newspaper, when you read about nuclear development, you'll come across the term nuclear fuel cycle. So nuclear fuel cycle means this. Now it's clear there. So when you now read, you'll be clear. When nuclear fuel cycle, matlab, ye sare process ko kehte hain. है ना, जहाँ पे फैसिलिटी डेवलप करना होता, राइट? सो वी हैव डेवलप द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर टुडे इंडिया, इन इंडिया वी हैव सेंटर्स सिस्टम्स ऑल डेवलप्ड, राइट? इज इट क्लियर दिस वन? सो दिस इज बेसिक कंसेप्ट, यू हैव टू नो दैट। हाँ, कौन सी ग्राम? नहीं नहीं ऐसे नहीं है, मैं मतलब कर सकते हैं, डायरेक्ट भी कर सकते हैं, ऐसा नहीं है। न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स, वी कैन टेक द यूरानियम एंड वी कैन एनरिच एंड कैन मेक वेपन्स, बट इफ एनी कंट्रीज हैज दिस टेक्नोलॉजी तो दे कैन टेक द प्लूटोनियम एंड कैन यूज फॉर द वेपन ऑल्सो देयर। दैट मीन वॉट यू कैन से डाइवर्जन ऑफ सिविल न्यूक्लियर प्रोग्राम इन टू वेपन प्रोग्राम। डिड यू गेट दैट? वी कैन मेक डायरेक्टली वेपन ऑल्सो देयर, बट वी कैन ऑल्सो यूज दिस रीप्रोसेसिंग टू मेक वेपन ऑल्सो देयर। एंड देयर वॉट इज अ थ्रेट देयर? एनी पीसफुल पर्पज फॉर पावर जनरेशन कैन बी डाइवर्टेड इन टू वेपन्स प्रोग्राम बिकॉज ऑफ रीप्रोसेसिंग एंड एनरिचमेंट। दैट पार्ट इज। सो वॉट वी हैव डन, यू नो दैट यू हैव रिस्टडी फ्रॉम आई आर, इंडियन गवर्नमेंट हैज सबमिटेड टू आई ए ई ए, राइट, दोज रिएक्टर्स विच वी आर यूजिंग ओनली फॉर पावर जनरेशन, वी हैव सबमिटेड टू द इंटरनेशनल एटोमिक एनर्जी एजेंसी टू देयर सुपरविजन एंड इंस्पेक्शन। दैट मीन्स आई ए ई ए कैन कम एनी टाइम टू इंडिया एंड कैन सी दैट वी आर नॉट डाइवर्टिंग, वी आर नॉट डाइवर्टिंग टू वेपन प्रोग्राम, वी आर ओनली एंड ओनली यूजिंग फॉर सिविलियन यूज, पीसफुल यूज। But there are few reactors which we have not handed over to IAEA. Why we have not handed over? Because we have nuclear weapon program in India and we also develop nuclear weapons. But stockpile, nobody knows how much a stockpile India has got. How many such nuclear bombs we have developed and kept there. So we have a dual program in that case. So those we are using peaceful purpose, we have handed over to IAEA. They can come inspect our nuclear reactors. That is Gindi, right? So you will come across this kind of term. And whenever you come across this term, let me write here, ENR. Sometimes in newspaper, you'll come across this word, ENR technologies. ठीक है? कभी भी newspaper में अगर ये word आता है, ENR technologies, तो ENR का मतलब है enrichment and reprocessing technology. Enrichment and reprocessing. यानी कि जो भी country है, अगर ENR टेक्नोलॉजी एक्वायर कर लेता है तो इसका मतलब है कि वो किसी भी तरह का यूज़ कर सकता है न्यूक्लियर टेक्नोलॉजी को। तो ENR टेक्नोलॉजी वर्ड बिकम्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड इंडिया हैज़ गॉट ENR टेक्नोलॉजी बिकॉज वी हैव डेवलप्ड, राइट? येस्टरडे आई वॉज डिस्कसिंग अबाउट थोरियम रिएक्टर, AHWR, एडवांस हैवी वाटर रिएक्टर। नाउ द क्वेश्चन इज दैट इफ़ वी हैव डेवलप्ड द रिएक्टर टेक्नोलॉजी, वाई नॉट वी आर यूजिंग थोरियम नाउ? बिकॉज वी हैव लिमिटेड यूरानियम बट वी हैव सो मच ऑफ थोरियम, तो वाई सच डिले इज देयर? बिकॉज वी आर डेवलपिंग दिस प्रोसेस। गेट द पॉइंट? टूडे वी हैव डेवलप द रिएक्टर, वी कैन यूज थोरियम रिएक्टर एंड वी हैव एडवांटेज। वाई, वॉट एडवांटेज? बिकॉज वी हैव अबंडेंट ऑफ थोरियम इन इंडिया, मोनाजाइट सैंड्स इन केरला। बट टूडे वी आर नॉट एबल टू डू कॉमर्शियल लेवल बिकॉज वी नीड टू सेट अप सच फैसिलिटीज फॉर थोरियम, बिकॉज थोरियम इन रॉ फॉर्म इज इन मोनाजाइट सैंड। तो वॉट इज दैट रिक्वायर्स? एक्सट्रैक्शन ऑफ थोरियम, देन थोरियम विल बी फैब्रिकेटेड, देन विल गो टू द पावर जनरेशन टू द रिएक्टर, देन वी हैव टू न्यूक्लियर वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट। सो दैट वी आर ट्राइंग टू डेवलप। सो इन कमिंग 4-5 years, इंडिया विल ऑल्सो हैव द थर्ड स्टेज, वी मे गो इन टू दैट पार्ट, राइट? एंड यू विल फाइंड दिस वन इन इंडिया एयर बुक। इंडिया एयर बुक विल हैव दिस काइंड ऑफ डिटेल इन्फॉर्मेशन, दैट्स वाई आई डिस्कस इन द क्लास रूम देयर। बिकॉज वैन यू रीड इंडिया एयर बुक, इंडिया एयर बुक इन द चैप्टर ऑफ साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी in the department of atomic energy, you will come across this particular area will be given there, right? Now what I'll do is that this is what I've explained here. If you can, I'll take you to the nuclear map of India. Let me just go into that. I have let's say nuclear map of India. Now in this nuclear map of India, you'll see that what all things we have developed in the country and what you have to do for this this area. You should always make sure to go to the website of BARC or DAE, where there you'll find such information given there. Let me come across nuclear waste management. This is a nuclear map of India. Okay, I don't have that, but I'll take it from the DAE site. So when you go to DAE, just one second, Department of Atomic Energy, let me open this website. Here is the website, Atoms in the Service of the Nation there. Now, when you go to the website there you'll find all the such names and things are given there, and you have the nuclear facilities in India where we have developed, like nuclear parks, I have said. So India has got very ambitious program. We have presently generating power. At the same time, we also want to scale up. We want to add up more nuclear parks in the country. And you know, Jetapur in Maharashtra, Kovada in Andhra Pradesh. Then we have Haripur program is there. Then now in Madhya Pradesh, Bargi and Haryana. Haryana is going to have a Gorakhpur Anu Vidyut Pariyojana. What is it? Gorakhpur is a one district in UP, but there's a Gorakhpur village in Haryana, which is going to have a nuclear power park, nuclear power reactors. So we have existing also, and we have future plans also. Now, when you go to here, you'll find this kind of information here. Department of Atomic Energy. So you have important here, publication part. And what is very important in this one? Annual report. Right. Now, look at here. What is given here? India becomes the associate member of CERN. Right. This is again current aspect of that. India becomes associate member of CERN. India's national statement of IAEA General Conference, that has been there. Civil Nuclear Cooperation in India, which all countries we have signed deals with, like, you know, Russia is already a strategic partner. With France, we have Kazakhstan, Mongolia, right, Japan. Now we have deals with Japan also, Canada. So you'll find all this information given in the on the website here. And power sector, you'll find reference NPCIL, Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited. And then this Indo-Russian civil nuclear deal. There's a cooperation for that. This one statement has been given there. Now, what you have to do here is on the website is that just go to the publication part. This is what I'm coming across here. Here. Annual report, DA's magazine, Nuclear India, Nuclear Facilities in India, this one. You'll find a map given there. And in the map, all such places have been mentioned where DA centers are there, this one. Atomic energy establishment in India. And it's very important, it's important for the exam also. See, the last time the UPSC asked question was only in 2011 and 2012 paper. So you might get question this year exam about such areas there, which I'm discussing right now. Now this is what you find here. So Srinagar we have nuclear research lab, BARC has a center there. Gulmarg in Jammu and Kashmir we have high altitude research lab. Then what is you have, Bahadurgarh, right, Bahadurgarh, Haryana. Very near to Delhi. There's a global center for nuclear energy partnership near to Delhi only. Then you have what? Narora, here, atomic power station, Bulandshahr. Then you have written here what? Delhi, Kasan, in there's a seismic array station there. Then Gandhinagar, Gujarat. Now let me first go into this part. What you find here? All these red dotted, what you find here, this part, where I'm putting the cursor there, these all are uranium mines of India. Let me just give the name there. One you find Jadugura Bhatin, Jharkhand. Uranium Corporation of India Limited. Uranium mills and mine, mill and mines are there, UCIL. This is given here. Let me further zoom out there. What do you see here is all the mines there. Now what is the name of the mines? Narwa Pahad. Right, then you have Jadugura Bhatin. Right. Then you'll find here one more name, Bagjata. You can see this arrow given, Bagjata. Uranium mine is there. Then you have here, above it is written, three more places are there. Bandhu Hurang, then you have Turamdi, Mohuldi. All in the same area, neighboring area. And from here we are mining the uranium. But what has happened? We have also found deposit of uranium elsewhere. Now you have one very, very important name given, Tumla Palle. You can see here, uranium mills and mine, Tumlapalle. Tumlapalle is in Andhra Pradesh, and Tumlapalle has a deposit of uranium. So Jadugura is the older one. But now we have also started doing mining from Tumlapalle. We are now taking out the uranium from Tumlapalle mines. Now this is a new mine, and it has got reserve of uranium. But in spite of that, we have several other places. Let me give you the names of the places where Atomic Mineral Directorate has found, located, uranium deposits. Meghalaya has got a deposit of uranium. So in Meghalaya, there are two places. Let me write the name there. In Meghalaya, uranium deposits in India. So in Meghalaya, there's two places called Wakhin. It came in the current aspect also, and what is called Domia Siat. You know that Meghalaya plateau is made of Garo, Khasi, and Jhentia. Three hills are there. As a part of Garo and Khasi, there are two places where uranium deposits are there. Right? Maybe in future, we can decide to go for mining. We can take out the uranium from there. Then Rajasthan. Rajasthan also has got uranium deposits. Anyone coming from Rajasthan here? Huh? We do देख रहा होगा जब राजस्थान में भी यूरेनियम डिपॉजिट है और हो सकता है कि इन कमिंग ईयर्स वी कैन डू द माइनिंग ऑफ यूरेनियम फ्रॉम राजस्थान एंड द नेम ऑफ द प्लेस आई एम गिविंग द इज अ पार्ट ऑफ सीकर डिस्ट्रिक्ट एंड रोहिल व्हाट इज द नेम देयर रोहिल देन सीकर डिस्ट्रिक्ट ऑफ राजस्थान देयर इज यूरेनियम डिपॉजिट हैव बीन फाउंड राइट देन कम्स हियर इफ यू टॉक अबाउट यूरेनियम डिपॉजिट्स Not only Meghalaya and Rajasthan, I have said about here, Andhra Pradesh, and you can locate from here. Can you tell me from geography what area is that? You have in the map there. So in Andhra Pradesh, Tumlapalli. Eastern Ghats and is a part of that Andhra Pradesh, not Telangana, Andhra Pradesh. You know Seshachalam Hills, Nellore, Kadapa, Kadapa. So one Kadapa is now Bahubali the conclusion. Tomorrow they will be there. Right. So Bahubali, the ending part, there you have Kadapa. So one is called Kadapa, Kadapa Basin, Kadapa in Andhra Pradesh. And there in Kadapa, there is a Tumlapalli near about that. There uranium deposits are there. That part is there, right? So we have now other places also having uranium. And for thorium, you know that thorium Kerala, not only Kerala, but there are other places also. Maximum deposit is Kerala. Kerala has got sand beaches there, and there you have thorium. Thorium is a part of something called rare earth elements, rare earth minerals. And there it lies in the monazite sand. So monazite sands are found in Kerala. That is one deposit. But also we have other places. Let me write here. It is found in Kerala also there. Odisha. Odisha also has got monazite deposit there. So certain areas. Then not Odisha, Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu also we have thorium deposits. Right? So though maximum is in Kerala, but there are other states also having the monazite sand deposit. Monazites are there, and we can go for extraction of thorium. So we are now developing technology to utilize thorium. Right? That's again our program. Scientific program is going on there. Right? Now, what you find here further? If you can see, there's a in the map here, you'll come across there in Mumbai. Right? In Mumbai, you have here heavy water board. There's a not mentioned there. Heavy water board is there. In Mumbai, you'll come across, and you have. Heavy water manufacturing. Yesterday, I said that in India we have developed PHWR, pressurized heavy water reactor. So, pressurized heavy water reactor requires heavy water deuterium oxide, but heavy water is not naturally available. So, we have to manufacture heavy water. So, we have manufacturing plants for heavy water. And what is the very important achievement of India? Today, India produces heavy water in such quantity that we export heavy water to other countries. India is a leading producer of heavy water in the world. Right? Worldwide, we have a more production of heavy water. And such heavy water, we sell to other countries, we earn money also. So we have a heavy water board which deals with such kind of manufacturing of heavy water. We have a setup of that. Then about you find here a different like Hazira, Gujarat. Heavy water plant is there, Talcher. Talcher in Odisha, we have a heavy water manufacturing plant. Then you have Thal. थाल इन महाराष्ट्र वी हैव हैवी वाटर प्लांट ये सभी जगहों पे हैवी वाटर बनाया जाता हैवी वाटर का एक तो यूज़ क्या है कूलेंट एंड मॉडरेटर इन न्यूक्लियर रिएक्टर बट हैवी वाटर इज ऑल्सो यूज इन मेडिसिनल पर्पज ऑल्सो बिकॉज पोलियो वैक्सीन यू नो पोलियो पोलियो वैक्सीन प्रिजर्वेशन दैट इज डन इन हैवी वाटर So it goes to the hospitals also. So there are other use of heavy water also. And we are manufacturing such heavy water, right? Now you'll find here, if you talk about this one, look at here, nuclear fuel complex, Hyderabad, right? And you have here, Atomic Mineral Directorate for Exploration Research, headquarters, Hyderabad. Then what you find here? Chennai and all this. Now Kalpakkam, Madras Atomic Power Station near to Chennai, right, which is a nuclear power generation. Now Tuticorin, heavy water plant, right? Then New Jerkorium, then Kudankulam. Now you can see clearly, Kudankulam is not northern side, Kudankulam is in southern side of Tamil Nadu. On the way to Rameswaram, you'll come across Kudankulam, coastal area, right? And then you have other centers here also there. Kollam in Kerala, low radiation research lab is there. Then Chavara in Kerala, mineral separation plant. Udyog Mandal, LV, Kerala, rare earth plants. Kaiga, generating power station in Karnataka. So we have such kind of centers established in India. So we have a huge network of establishment in the country. So this is a kind of a India yearbook kind of information. You have to know the water centers, how they are involved, what are the various activities carried out in the country. Annual report of DAE will also give you the information. Now what I'm adding here, important part from the examination, which UPSC can ask the question there. One area you could get question, nuclear reactor. Another area question can be nuclear fuel cycle. Third area could be establishment. A question can be asked. Now what is fourth area? Apart from nuclear power generation, what are the other applications of nuclear technologies? So now I'm coming to other area applications. So where all applications are there? I'll make a flow chart and put the things there. See, nuclear technologies are used in agriculture, food industry, medical healthcare, industrial application. We have so many use of nuclear technologies, and not only India, worldwide, such kind of technologies are readily available and being deployed, used in the market there. So let us understand other applications of nuclear technologies. So I'll put across in the flowchart here. And I'll give you the examples also there, where you'll find, and I'll take you to one of the documents there, and that document will be uploaded in the your student platform also, but I'll take you where the source is there. But let me first make this flowchart. The first thing comes here, agriculture. And I'm giving you two applications. First application, that in terms of high yield variety seeds, gamma radiation based, now here, gamma radiation technology to develop high yield variety, HYV, high yield variety seeds, agriculture. What scientists do, they take the seeds of plants, crop plants, let's say rice or wheat or let's say pulses, gamma rays are passed. You know the gamma rays are highly penetrating. And what gamma rays will cause? It will cause DNA mutation, change in DNA. And then what the scientists do, they screen out those kind of seeds, and some few of the seeds will become high yield varieties. So that kind of high yield varieties, what is called Trombe varieties, I'm writing here, Bark Center, they develop these Trombe varieties. And there are field trials going on, scientific trials for such kind of varieties have been carried out there, right? Now what is second use of nuclear technology, agriculture? We can process food. Like gamma radiation can base processing of food. What will happen there? It will kill the germs, it will kill the bacteria and viruses. Food will not get spoiled, right? Food will remain as a fresh storage, right? Storage can be increased. At the same time, decontamination. So let me write here, food preservation, food processing technology. And you'll be surprised to know, and कई सारे चीजों पे food processing किया जा रहा है. Like example, garam masala, spices. You know, onion. You know, kanda. प्याज. In Maharashtra में बोलते हैं kanda. तो kanda में क्या होता है? या प्याज में क्या होता है? पत्ते निकल जाते हैं. Leaves, sprouting. If you keep potato, aloo, in the room temperature for long time, there you green color and then again leaves comes out, sprouting. Those kind of sprouting can be prevented. So let me write here, onions. Then, you know, suji and rava, right, rava also. So rava is also there. Then, you know, seafood can be processed. Aajkal aam ka season hai, mangoes are can be processed there. Flowers, right? Valentine's Day, your flower day, ठीक है, चला गया वैलेंटाइंस डे तो चला गया है, आने वाला नहीं, जा चुका है. फ्लावर डे कब होता है? फ्लावर डे फ्लावर्स डे होता है नहीं? अच्छा हाँ, रोज डे, फ्लावर डे. तो आजकल बाजार में इतना फ्रेश क्यों होते हैं? यू जस्ट गिव अ थिंग दैट थिंकिंग दैट कि जब ये जितने गुलाब के फूल होते हैं या जो फ्लावर्स होते हैं वो रखते कैसे? कम्स फ्रॉम ट्रांसपोर्ट ना. एंड फ्लावर्स जस्ट यू टेक, अब जब आप खरीदते हो तो उसे फ्रेश होता है, जब आप दे देते हो तो फिर कुछ दिन के बाद वो चला जाता है वहाँ. दिस थिंग देयर राइट. सो हाँ, तो दे यूज द दिस काइंड टेक्नोलॉजी. सो फ्लावर्स ऑल्सो देयर, ऑल दिस आर प्रोसेस्ड राइट. सो नाउ यू कैन सी द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ न्यूक्लियर टेक्नोलॉजी. नाउ कम्स द क्वेश्चन, इफ इट ईट सच काइंड ऑफ थिंग विल नॉट दैट वी गेट रेडिएशन inside the body? It can be there, no? It's natural question is that if we take such kind of food processed by gamma rays, so what harmful effect on human body will be there? But such foods are certified by FSSAI, Food Safety and Standard Authority of India. So then only we'll go to the market. It's not that government will simply send let all those kind of food. But aise kai food hai jo ki harmful hai lekin bazaar mein bik raha hai. So that is in there. So that is what comes there. Now I'm coming to here, medicine, healthcare. Now tell me what all thing of application in healthcare comes. First is diagnosis. What I'm writing here, biomedical diagnosis. How the diagnosis can be done? We can find out the cancer and tumor, location of tumor, location of cancer. And for that we carry out some kind of scanning process there. So let me write example here. Example, PET, I have written here. PET CT scan, scanning for tumors or cancer. PET stands for, let me write, positron emission tomography. Emission tomography. This instrument, just like, you know, CT scan in hospital, you have seen that. Now PET CT scan can scan brain, can find out brain tumors, can locate the tumors, diagnosis can be done. And then what comes the next one? Second, therapy. Nuclear therapy, nuclear treatment. What we use in therapy treatment? We use radioisotopes, cobalt-60 cancer treatment, gamma radiation based. So here, example, let's say cobalt-60 isotope based cancer treatment. And such kind of a cancer treatment, there's a word for that, I'm writing here, teletherapy. You'll come across a word, radiotherapy or teletherapy. You all are aware of one word, chemotherapy. And those who get cancer there, and chemotherapy is there. And there's something called radiation therapy. Gamma rays are passed or radioisotopes are used to those organs which has got the cancer or tumor. And in India, we have developed a very important instrument. Bark scientists have developed what is called Bhabhatron. Bhabhatron is there. So let me write the here. Here, Bhabhatron. Now, Bhabhatron is a teletherapy machine. Is a radiation therapy machine, which we have now not only using in India, but we have also given to Mongolia, Kazakhstan. We have gifted Bhabhatron. Indian government has gifted Bhabhatron to countries like Central Asian country like Mongolia and all this. They are also using for cancer treatment. And it is given in India yearbook. Very, very important. It is given in India yearbook. Like, remember that. Kuch bhi jo aise cheezein, nahi cheezein hoti hain India yearbook mein, you cannot take a risk. Ho sakta hai question aaja. There might be a direct question in the exam. Ki Bhabhatron 2 is related to what? ABCD. Cancer treatment. Cobalt 60 based. So it is done by our center there. This is what I have given there. Right. Then I am coming to industry. Now tell me industry, industrial area, what all applications are there? Industrial applicants. Any one application. Nuclear technology industries. Defense is one area, but other than defense, normal industrial application. Gamma ray cameras are there, cameras, scanners. So let me write here first, what called Rolly camera, Rolly. I'll show you all those photographs. Rolly camera as a scanning machine is a scanner. Where can we use? Metallurgy, you know, metals. Sometimes, you know, you require those type of metal which are foolproof, without any defect, without any crack. Like for example, metro. You know how the metro project is being constructed? The pillar. If any kind of crack generates in the pillar, it's going to be dangerous. Because such load is there, which is there on the track. And if the crack is there, the crack, what happens? It becomes bigger and bigger in size. And that can fall also there. That was the case, if you remember, this airport line. There was a crack developed on the pillars. And in that case, the repair was done. Right, right. So what I want to say, such kind of infrastructure project, bridges, highways, right, which require what? Foolproof metal. This should not be any kind of crack. How we can scan? We have such kind of cameras, gamma ray camera, which can scan the metals. So sometimes such kind of metallic application, so that can be part of metallurgy. Metallurgy application is there. There it comes into that. Now I'll give you another very important application. Oil and gas pipeline. The pipeline which carries the oil and gas. And you know that refineries, wherever we have refineries, all these are through the pipeline. It goes through the pipeline. Now imagine if there is any kind of leakage. It can happen there, leakage in the pipeline. So there will be again a problem will be there. So there's something called sensor, radiation-based sensors, which can detect the leakages from oil and gas pipeline. So I'm adding here second, detection of leakages in oil and gas pipeline. Oil and gas pipeline. That can be applications. Now, many of the industrial processes, they require neutron beam, neutron or electron, protons. So there comes what technology? Cyclotron or synchrotron, which can make the charged particle acquire high energy. So cyclotron, again, nuclear technology comes. I'll write it here. Third one is cyclotron. Then you know that laser technology, laser. Many of the industrial processes, they use laser beam or laser technologies are there. And such laser technologies, again, will be based on nuclear aspect. Right? So you have to learn not only nuclear reactors and power generation, you have to also know the other areas of applications. And that can be a question asked in the exam. Now I'm taking you to the document given on the website. And that document you'll have on the your student platform also. But I'm just taking you to the source also. When you go back here, Department of Atomic Energy, when you go to here, see, DAE is Nuclear India Magazine. There's a magazine there, Nuclear India Magazine. There you'll find this newsletter or magazine. Here is given, when you go to this one, I'm opening here this one, July 1, now look at here. अभी आजकल यही छाए हुए हैं. अब मोदी के बाद योगी का नंबर आ गया. जहां देखो मीडिया में मोदी एंड योगी, टू पीपल आर देयर. और कल एक न्यूज में आ रहा था, देयर इज वन आईपीएस ऑफिसर, डीजीपी ऑफ उत्तर प्रदेश, सुखलान सिंह, राइट. वो भी कह रहे थे ही इज अनदर योगी. आजकल सब योगी बन रहे हैं. नो, ईमानदार, दैट मीन ही वाज वेरी इज अ डीजीपी ऑफ यूपी स्टेट एंड आईपीएस ऑफिसर. सो देयर वाज कवरेज ऑन दैट, ही स्टिल लिव्स इन अ थ्री रूम house with his children and everything, and not any kind of corruption, nothing of that kind. So there are imandar IPS and IAS officers also in the country. That was the coverage there. Now look at here, this one. So Modi ji yahan par hai, kahan par hai? Mongolia mein. Theek hai, aapka dhyan Modi ji pe hona chahiye, kahin aur dhyan nahi dena hai. Theek hai. So our prime minister here, Narendra Modi, with a group of nurses, Mongolian nurses. This photograph is there, right? And what is given here? Now look at here. Very, very important here. What is given? Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi, during his visit to National Cancer Center of Mongolia while gifting of Bhabhatron II. teletherapy equipment. And Bhabhatron is in the India Yearbook also given. It's only the matter of time when question comes in the exam. Okay? Clear this? This document has given Bhabhatron, what is it, cancer treatment. Now look at here further. Now if you go by this document, you have the addresses and all. This is not that important, but I'll come to application part of it. In the same document, you have, look at here this one. Smartphone app. Launch of cancer staging. What do you mean by staging? Any doctor in the classroom? Initially tumor is benign. Then what happened? Malignant. Tumor becomes malignant, cancer. So there are different stages of development of cancer. And what happens at the last stage? There's something called metastasis. What is metastasis? Where the cancer spread to the organs. And that is more dangerous because there also teletherapy, radiation therapy will not help. If the last stage comes, there you know that doctor says that. But Bhagwan ko, upar wale ko karo, kab ja sakte hain upar. This is what is happening there. And I'm telling you that cancer is on rise in India. Right? 30, 40 years, there were not that such kind of cases. But now many such cases are coming in India. Right? And because of the many factors, it's not a single factor. We are in the environment where radiations are there. We are taking those food which are carcinogenic, which can cause cancer in the body, right? There are viruses which can cause cancer to the body, like human papilloma virus, which cause cancer to women, cervical cancer, right? Hepatitis, you know, hepatitis B, which cause liver damage. Hepatitis means liver. But hepatitis virus can also cause liver cancer. So their viruses also cause cancer. Then lack of vitamin, lack of mineral, right? Those can also cause cancer. So many factors are there. So there this Bhabhatron can help people in terms of if initial stages have been detected. So now this smartphone app is there. Then what do you find here? You find here this one, very important one about this. Look at here. Environment monitoring around nuclear reactors. Around nuclear reactors, there will be radiations will be there. And that has to be monitored. So what BARC does, or Atomic Energy Regulatory Board, AERB, we have stations around nuclear reactors, which monitors the radiation. If the radiation goes beyond a threshold limit, then work has to be done, action has to be taken, because people who live near to the nuclear parks, they will be at risk. Or those who work in the nuclear reactors or park, those people who are working inside the nuclear park, they will be at risk. So environmental monitoring, that is done there. Then what do you find here? Further, you'll find in this case, this kind of solar equipments are given there. Now they have done there. Now look at here, this one. This is what I've given in the flowchart here. Radiation technology developed in BARC for value addition to food and agro commodities. And now you can see here, gamma rays, cobalt 60, cesium-137, then you accelerated electrons, electron accelerators or X-rays. Now what are the benefits given here? See here. Low dose, if you take low dose, inhibition of sprouting in tubers, bulbs and rhizomes. There will not be sprouting there. Low dose treatment is done. Then insect disinfestation in stored grains, pulses and product. There will not be insect in those kind of products. And destruction of parasites in meat and meat product, you know, pork. And pig and pork. Pork, the pig contain tapeworm. And that can cause disease, those person who take pork as a food, meat product. So what can be done? Gamma rays, which can kill those kind of insects and those kind of parasites. Right? Parasites can be killed. Right? Seafood can also be there. Now you can see medium dose. What is a medium dose? Elimination of spoilage, microbes in fresh fruit and meat and poultry. Then what is given? Elimination of food pathogen in meat and poultry. Then hygienization of spices and herbs. High dose, sterilization of food for special requirement. Then what is this self-stable food? All these have been tried out at BARC Center, and there are products which are there in the market, which have been approved by the government. Right? It's clearly given. Such kind of things you will not find in newspaper and all this. And sometimes the question comes from such kind of a reports and newsletter. That's what I'm trying to make you aware also there. Then you come across here, this one, safety international approval, FAO, Food and Agriculture Organization, IAEA, International Atomic Energy Agency, and then you have WHO, World Health Organization, and there's something called International Codex Alimentarius. Let me write this. This is a food safety standard called Codex Alimentarius. This is a guideline, right? This is a guideline there. Alimentarius is given. Alimentarius, what is given? This is a commission, right? This commission has been set up at UN level, and it gives the guidelines for food safety. And which body implements in India? FSSAI, Food Safety Standard Authority of India, based on this kind of a commission and guidelines, right? So you have those kind of approved one. Approval is required. Then only it will go to the market. Then you'll find here what this which has been allowed. Now see, these are table given: onion, potato, shallots, rice, semolina, pulses, dried seafood, raisins, figs, dried dates, mango. Mango is also given there. Meat and meat products, including chicken. Then fresh seafood, frozen seafood, spices, and all is given here. Purpose. On what purpose is there? Clear? So that's what I have linked those areas and provided there, right? Now I'll play a documentary. So let me come to a documentary part of it. Clear that this a body here, this is a UN body, which gives the guidelines for food safety and standards. So food safety can be many things. Here also food safety comes because we are using gamma rays. It has to be safer one. There comes a safety part of that. Let me see what video I have got there. Atomic energy. I had where it has gone there. Let me see that. Okay, what I'm playing right now, because since we'll be now learning biotechnology, is a very comic one. You know that one cartoon which comes in news channel, So Sorry, Aastak comes into that. There's another kind of cartoon which comes in NDTV, Gustaki Maaf. So I'm playing that Gustaki Maaf.
सिर्फ गुस्ताखी माफ में आपका स्वागत है। थाली का बैगन बनना हमारी पुरानी परंपरा का हिस्सा है, लेकिन अब एक उलझन पैदा हो गई है कि थाली का बैगन बने दो, लेकिन सादा बैगन या फिर बीटी बैगन। अगर दिमाग पर ज्यादा जोर पड़ रहा है तो बैगन छोड़िए, टमाटर उठाइए और एक दूसरे पर फेंकने लगिए।
बस बस इनफ, बहस का ये कोई तरीका नहीं, चिल्लाना बंद। चलिए शराफत और तहजीब के साथ बैठ के बात करें। लंच लाओ, भूखे पेट बहस हजम नहीं होगी ना।
इतने महंगे हो गए है तो मत खाओ ना है, वैसे भी डायबिटीज हो जाती है, कड़वा घूट पी लो भाई।
सिर्फ बातों से कुछ नहीं, लेकिन बातों में अगर सिर्फ तारीफ हो तो बहुत कुछ हो सकता है, खास तौर से अगर सभी लोग एक दूसरे की तारीफ कर रहे हैं। माओवादी अगर बातचीत नहीं कर रहे, इसकी वजह ये हो सकती है कि शायद अब तक उनकी किसी ने तारीफ नहीं की है।
चिदम्बरम साहेब, वाह वाह, नेशनल सिक्योरिटी का क्या कहना, वाह वाह, इंडिया महान, वाह वाह,
लाइक वाह वाह मोदी जी, लाइक वाह,
industry, udyog, like vikas and development in Gujarat, like wah, wah, India mahan, like wah, wah.
Wah, wah, Mukesh bhai, wah, wah. Finance, wealth creation, bhuke nango ko naukri dena, aur India ko confidence dena, wah, wah, wah. Indian industry mahan, wah, wah, wah.
Wah, wah, mashallah, wah, wah.
Next part is about Naxalism and all this. But this two part, what the first part there, B.T. Brinjal. This is an old documentary. It was, you know, that B.T. Brinjal government wanted to bring into the market in 2011 there. And then there was all protest against the B.T. Brinjal. And then the government put a moratorium, that is suspension mode. Only one product which is there in the market, that is a cotton, B.T. cotton. And now it has come GM mustard. Now what is being considered a GM mustard. So that time this particular cartoon was there. So let us understand here, when you talk about biotechnology, now this energy resources and nuclear technology and all this, what is very important one need to see initially in the very first class when I took the, when I started science and technology, there I have mentioned about all the application of biotechnology. I have said about agriculture biotechnology, then I have said about the medical biotechnology, green biotech, red biotech, blue biotech. I have given the flowchart kind of thing. Now what we need to understand here, we have to learn the techniques of biotechnology, few important concepts of biotechnology there. So let us understand things there, because since in this batch biology has not been done, so I'll try to link with those areas where you'll be able to link with the biological aspect also there. Because since biotechnology linked with biology, so one needs a kind of a background there. Have you done biology here? Ho chuka hai, toh theek hai tum. So let me then ask the question. So what is genetic engineering? What is genetic engineering? So now that's what I'm saying. We need to learn about some few basic techniques there. But I'll not teach in that way, because we don't require that kind of too much of biology there. We don't have to become a molecular biologist. That is not required. We need to understand the basic concept of genetic engineering and pros and cons, positive and negative side, and at the same time, the policy perspective. So let us come to that. So now if we talk about tools and techniques in biotechnology, because when you read current aspect, you'll come across such kind of terms there. Terminology will be there. So it is very important to know about those terminologies. First one comes here, recombinant DNA technology. Because many times you'll come across recombinant protein. The word given, recombinant protein, recombinant insulin, and recombinant word is linked with this particular technology called a recombinant DNA technology. This technology is popularly known as genetic engineering. This technique is also known as, another name there, also called as, also known as gene cloning. What is gene cloning? So anyone from biology background here in the classroom or coming from biotechnology background who can throw light? Genetic engineering. Okay. You're right there. Right. So what is done in the genetic engineering? उन्होंने बताया होगा ना वो तो जो चेयर में बैठ के पढ़ाए होगा वो कई टीचर चेयर में बैठ के पढ़ाते हैं ना मैं नहीं पढ़ाता हूँ मेरी आदत नहीं है चेयर में बैठने ऐसे भी मुझे बड़ा ऊंचा सा लगता है ये तो बड़ा अजीब सा लगता है मुझे बैठने में हाँ जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग क्या पढ़ाया तो हाँ पढ़ाया होगा ऐसा पक्का नहीं पढ़ाया था अच्छा उनको बाद में पता चल गया कि मैं आ चुका हूँ तो इसलिए तो बायोटेक्नोलॉजी एरिया उन्होंने साइड कर दिया एनी वे कोई एक बताना चाहिए कि व्हाट एग्जैक्टली इज डन देयर एनी आइडिया आई विल कम टू ऑल डिटेल पार्ट ऑफ बट एनी आइडिया ऑन दैट केस एंड देन आई विल गिव यू सर्टेन नोट्स आल्सो देयर जीन ओके सी रिमेंबर दैट जेनेटिक इंजीनियरिंग और रिकॉम्बिनेंट डीएनए टेक्नोलॉजी इज अ मॉलिक्यूलर बायोलॉजी टेक्निक to make transgenic animals and plants. What is the word here? Transgenic animals and plants. So what is very important here is a method, is a lab method to develop the word is a transgenics. What do you mean by transgenics? Transgenic means transfer of gene from one organism to another. That's what the word comes here. It's a method to develop transgenic organisms. And that organisms can be animal, can be plant, it even can be microorganism like bacteria or fungi. That could also be there. Now transgenic animals, now transgenic means transfer of gene. That means today, using recombinant DNA technology, we can manipulate, we can transfer gene or DNA from one living organism to another and for various traits and applications. That can be done. Now what happens here is that it uses certain type of enzymes. Enzymes to cut DNA, cut and join DNA molecules. Right? In this method, it uses enzymes to cut and join DNA molecules. And what comes the second one here? Vectors. It uses vectors. What are vectors? These vectors will carry, as a carrier molecule, it will carry gene of interest, right, from one organism to another. Vector is important because it inserts gene, that is a vector is required. And what is required? And host cell, where genes will be expressed. And host cells to express gene. To express genes there. Let's take example. For example, we want insulin, right? Insulin which is produced by pancreatic cell, beta cells of Langerhans or pancreas which produce insulin. Now we want that the same insulin, human insulin, not produced by human but produced by bacteria. So we can genetically engineer the bacteria, or what we say, genetically modify the bacteria, and the bacteria will become a biofactory, and such bacteria will make human insulin. And today in the market, such insulin are sold. So the basic thing requires here a set of enzymes to cut and join DNA, that means manipulate genetic aspect, genetic information, then a vector to carry the gene of interest, and the host cell. The host cell can be a bacterium, it can be a plant or animal, that can be there. So what I'll do right now, I will now first draw a schematic diagram to make you understand how insulin is produced. Then I'll give you one paragraph right upon that, okay, how exactly the manipulation is done. So from the examination point of view, that is will be sufficient to keep in mind, because remember that in UPSC exam, it will never ask you write DNA or this is genetic engineering or write any kind of this. That will not be asked in main exam. Question will always be analytical. The technique has to be back of the mind. That you have to remember that, right? So let us first explain how insulin is made. So I'll put across in the diagram here, and then I'll give you a paragraph writing on that. It is done in this way. First time which was tried to make this kind of human insulin, recombinant insulin, what scientists did was that took the human cell. See, insulin gene will be part of human cell only, right? And that gene has to be inserted into a bacteria. So it was the first time done like that. Let's say this is a human cell, right? From here, you know, nucleus contains chromosome. So from here, the gene was extracted. This is an insulin gene, right? Now what was done? A bacteria was taken. The bacteria E. coli, Escherichia coli. Now bacteria are said to be prokaryotes. What are prokaryotes? They do not contain nucleus bound by nuclear membrane. So what is there in that case? This kind of bacteria, which has a cytoplasm, it's a DNA, DNA is there, and E. coli contain a circular DNA, which I'm drawing here. This circular piece of DNA, it's called plasmid. What is a plasmid? Plasmid is a circular chromosome or circular DNA of bacteria. It is found in the E. coli bacteria. So what scientists did? They broke this cell, took this plasmid outside. This plasmid was there. And then what was done? Restriction enzyme. Use of restriction enzyme. Restriction enzyme. Restriction enzymes are those enzymes which can cut DNA at a specific site. It can locate the DNA at certain types, place it can make a cut, make a nick, just like molecular scissor. So what happened was that this was DNA was cut open, right? And in this case, the human insulin, this one, was joined there. And for that, DNA ligase, there's another enzyme called DNA ligase enzyme was used. So use of DNA ligase. So what happened? This DNA here plasmid, let me just change the color here. Let's say this is the insulin. So here human insulin gene was added. So ligase like a Fibi stick or glue, right? It can glue together, join together the two different DNAs to make a single DNA. So now it contains what? Insulin. Here insulin, human insulin is there. Now this molecule, what is made in the lab, is called recombinant DNA, recombinant, recombination. Recombining DNA of a bacteria with DNA of human. This is called recombinant DNA. This word comes here, recombinant DNA. And what type of DNA is a plasmid? Is a plasmid. Now this plasmid act like a vector. This becomes a vector carrier. Yeah, this is a carrier there. ठीक है तो इसमें क्या किया गया ह्यूमन सेल से इंसुलिन निकाला गया बैक्टीरियल सेल लिया गया वहाँ से प्लाज्मिड लिया गया सर्कुलर डीएनए उसको काटा गया रेस्ट्रिक्शन एंजाइम से और वहाँ पे इंसर्ट किया गया ह्यूमन इंसुलिन जिन को लाइगेज एंजाइम से अब ये जो रिकॉम्बिनेंट प्लाज्मिड है दैट बिकम्स अ वेक्टर कैरियर मॉलिक्यूल एंड इट हैज़ टू बी एक्सप्रेस्ड तो वेयर इट हैज़ टू बी एक्सप्रेस्ड इट हैज़ टू गो इनसाइड द बैक्टीरियल सेल नाउ दिस बैक्टीरियल सेल कंटेन दैट प्लाज्मिड हियर which contain human insulin. Now the bacteria, now this becomes what? Host, the host cell. Now the bacteria will recognize this gene, right, which contains insulin information as its own DNA, own gene, and will make the insulin. Bacteria will make the insulin. And this we can grow in a kind of a reactor. We have specially designed reactor in a bioreactor and this bacteria grows there and produce insulin, right? So here insulin production is there. What scientists did in the lab, first they made the recombinant plasmid, insert into bacteria. Now this bacteria, which is now carrying the human insulin gene, this bacteria was grown, right, where? In a reactor, bioreactor. And since the bacteria will recognize human insulin as its own gene or DNA, will make the insulin protein, insulin hormone. And we can purify from the reactor. And such kind of insulin sold in the market as a recombinant insulin, where you know diabetes people, a diabetes patient require those kind of insulin injection. That injection which contains insulin, human insulin is made from bacteria, not from the humans. That was the first time manipulation done. And from here, insulin is taken. Will make this, right? This was first time carried out. Right? Biotechnology way, it was carried out. But what is very important? Today, using the same method, right? Today, using the same method, we can take gene from any organism, put in another. Let's say, for example, just take one very good example. I'm giving you a good example that, let's say, for example, BT cotton, right? So what is the name BT here? Bacillus thuringiensis. Cotton is a plant, BT is a bacteria. What scientists did? Took the gene of the bacteria, Bacillus thuringiensis, and inserted into a cotton. Here we are talking human insulin, human gene into bacteria. But what happened? BT cotton, a bacterial gene into cotton plant. Right, so that's what we can create any kind of such kind of transfer among the living organisms. Right, that is what the genetic engineering comes into that. Right, so you can write there. I'll give you certain. Just write in one paragraph. The what diagram I have given, I'll put into a paragraph there. I'm giving from my book only there. So just I'll give you the main part of it. Now write this in paragraph. The ability to obtain specific DNA, the ability to obtain specific DNA, obtain specific DNA from one organism and inserted from one organism and inserted to another organism and inserted into another organism is known as genetic engineering. Now you full stop. In this method, DNA molecules from two different species. In this method, DNA molecules from two different species can be joined together to create recombinant DNA molecule, which is then inserted into a host organism to express the gene of interest. Now bring full stop. In the lab, express gene of interest. Full stop. In the lab, DNA molecule is cut with the help of restriction endonuclease enzyme. Give a full stop there. Plasmid is a circular chromosome found in bacteria such as E. coli. Give us stop there. Such plasmid acts as a vector molecule. Now you will stop there. The plasmid is cut with the help of restriction enzyme to create a slot. Where gene to be expressed such as human insulin gene can be joined. Human insulin gene can be joined with the help of can be joined with the help of DNA ligase with the help of DNA ligase L-I-G-A-S-E ligase enzyme DNA ligase enzyme now to full stop such recombinant plasmid is further cloned and inserted and inserted into bacterial cells, inserted into bacterial cells, which are bacterial cells which are grown in a specially designed bioreactor. Right. Bioreactor. Right. Three words. Bioreactor to produce insulin. Right. So the method what I put in schematic form, I have just given a paragraph there. Again, आपको याद रखना है, ये कभी भी यूपीएससी में आपसे मॉलिकुलर बायोलॉजी नहीं पूछा जाएगा. हाँ, ये पता होना चाहिए कौन सा एंजाइम कट करता है, कौन सा जॉइन करता है, क्या वेक्टर मॉलिक्यूल है, ये पता होना चाहिए. व्हाट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर यूपीएससी एग्जाम, एप्लीकेशन. नाउ टेल मी एप्लीकेशन हियर, लेट मी ऐड समथिंग, देन विल गो फॉर द ब्रेक देयर. व्हाट इज एप्लीकेशन ऑफ दिस मेथड, इज वेरी सिंपल, यू ऑल आर अवेयर द एप्लीकेशंस आर ऑल दिस वन. वी कैन हैव वैरायटी ऑफ different organism with different traits. So let's say from agriculture perspective, I'll just put into that. From agriculture perspective, let me just write about those things. Let me write this one. Let's come to that. If we talk about advantages and applications of this technology, so I'll give few example also, very, very important example, and where again question can be asked. The first one is that pesticidal effect, we know BT. See, whenever the word BT word comes, BT, remember that insecticidal, pesticidal effect. And I'll give you the name of gene also there. Pesticidal or insecticidal properties, if you want. Here comes example of BT crops. Now, what is done here? As I said, BT stands for Bacillus thuringiensis. Let me write the name of the bacteria. Scientists were aware, right? Scientists were aware that this bacteria is found in soil, and this bacteria has a property of insecticidal effect. Later on, scientists found that this bacteria contain a gene called Cry gene. CRY1AC. This gene is there, right? This Cry1AC gene. That gene gives the insecticidal protein because it makes what? A type of protein called as endotoxic protein is there. It makes a protein which is endotoxic. So, jab aise plant mein, let's say cotton, where this gene is there, the cotton plant will produce this kind of protein, will endotoxic to insect or pest. And when insect eats the plant, right, this protein goes inside the insect and the digestive system of insect is disrupted and insect dies. Then insects are killed because of this protein. So what genetic information lies in the protein? This kind of gene. So scientists were aware of this information. So what scientists did? Took this gene and added into crop plant through genetic engineering, genetic modification. So whether you have cotton or brinjal or mustard, you take any example. So that kind of property is given by this particular gene to the crop plant, right? Now let's look at second example. We can use genetic modification, genetic engineering, to create drought and flood resistant varieties. And our scientists have been making this one. Right, today in PT 365, you'll come to know such kind of varieties which we have been made. But I'll give you the, let's say for example, rice variety. And you know that India is vulnerable to climate change impact. So either we have too much of rains or there's lack of rain. And this condition happens every year. Before the rains comes, drought, famine. Right, drought happens there. And after when rain comes, flood. So in that case, we can make this one. Then comes your third what? High yield varieties. We can make high yield varieties. Now from current aspect, what is coming? GM mustard. So what is GM mustard? Herbicidal effect. For here example comes GM mustard. So now you see that it is called GM mustard. It is not called BT mustard. Can you see the word? The BT you will only find for insecticidal effect. GM is a generic term. It can be anything. It can be modification for any kind of trait or property. Then I'm giving another very important one. Biofortification, biofortified, addition of nutrients. So here, biofortified, right, plants or crops. And I'm giving you one example, golden rice. Golden rice contain vitamin A, pro vitamin A. When we take this rice, when we eat this rice, in our body, vitamin A will be made, which is very important to prevent getting night blindness. Because lack of vitamin A causes night blindness. So what scientists have done? Have taken a gene from maize plant, corn, makka, and that gene has been added into the rice variety. Again, genetic engine. So golden rice. Then I'll give you another example. Let me write sixth one here. Temperature tolerant varieties, high temperature, low temperature. And I'll give you one example also here. Temperature tolerant variety. So high temperature, or it can be for low temperature. And I'm giving you from example from Department of Biotechnology, where GM strawberry has been made, strawberry. You know, GM strawberry, actually normal strawberry is grown in hilly areas. Right, when you go to Mahabaleshwar and Himachal Pradesh and all this, you'll find this kind of strawberry plantation. Strawberry is not tall trees. Strawberries are small kind of plants there. And what happens in hilly areas? Frost. There may be low temperature frost. And frost will damage such kind of strawberries. So what scientists have done? Our scientists have created GM strawberry, which will not be damaged because of frost. So it is a frost resistant variety. Frost tolerant variety. So even there will be frost or snowfall will be there, such kind of strawberries will not be destroyed. See, today we are not using it, but these all have been worked out, developed. And now comes the question, from where the gene has come? Is strawberry mein ek bacteria hai jo ki soil mein hota, rhizobium. Rhizobium bacteria, aapko pata hai, biofertilizer in terms of root nodules. Rhizobium bacteria contains a gene by which it can tolerate low temperature, cold condition. So what scientists did? Identified that gene from rhizobium bacteria and inserted into strawberry. So strawberry has got the property of that bacteria, low temperature tolerant. This has been done. Then one more example, seventh one. I'm giving one very good example. Storage, high storage vessel. That means a long storage or long shelf life. I'm giving one very good example of a tomato, right? Tomato, Flower Sour is a tomato variety which will not spoiled. It can remain as a without getting spoiled for 25-30 days. Ek mahine tak bahar rakh sakte ho, will not get affected. So here, this Flower Sour, tomato has a long storage there. This has been developed there. So I mean to say, we can create any such kind of varieties through genetic modification. Now my question, why people are protesting then? We have so much of benefits, such kind of manipulation, genetic engineering, genetic modification, we can make such kind of things there. So what are the problems then? It's good that we have drought resistant, low temperature resistant, right, then why the people are resenting against the GM varieties? If we have such kind of development, we should use in the agriculture. We should use in the market. Ill effects of the genes, okay? Then? Right? This all you are aware because you all have read in newspaper and all this. All these arguments which are given. These are the positive side we have said. But negative sides are also there. So let me just put across there. I'll just remove this. If you talk about negative sides, so there again many, many negative sides are there. That's why today, worldwide, you'll not find so much of cultivation. But again, the concerns have been raised. So let me write here. Concerns or negative side of this thing. Negative aspects. Right. Now let me write first one. The first negative side or concern is that health impact. How it can impact the health, right? Not only health of humans, it can be for animals also there. Like for example, what can be one argument? One argument is like this. BT brinjal will be taken as a food, right? BT cotton we will not consume. See, GM food, cotton is just a fabric. But when you talk about BT brinjal, BT potato, BT corn, all will be eaten by humans. What if the same protein, cry protein, goes into the stomach and affect the human health? That is the argument given there. It can be taken by humans and humans consumption in that protein which is made by the BT gene can affect the health of the humans, right? But there is an argument against that also. If you go by scientist argument, scientist says that scientists say that our stomach, human stomach is acidic. So even though we eat BT brinjal, I will contain that protein, but this protein will be neutralized in the stomach. Because that protein only affects insect and pest, not humans. So वही एक debate बना हुआ है कि भुरता खाए तो कौन सा खाए, सादा बैंगन का भुरता या BT बैंगन, that is thing there. So which one you want to eat? कौन सा आपको BT or normal? You were given the choice in the market. You have normal brinjal and BT brinjal. Normal? BT why? बैगन खा रहे हैं वो ठीक है, बैगन खा रहे हैं. आज के टाइम में जो बैंगन मार्केट में मिल रहा है, द ब्रिंजल विच इज देयर इन द मार्केट कंटेन पेस्टिसाइड रेसिड्यू, राइट? वी यूज द पेस्टिसाइड ना, इंसेक्टिसाइड, केमिकल पेस्टिसाइड, एंड दे ऑल गो इन द ह्यूमन बॉडी. दैट इज मोर हार्मफुल. इट्स बेटर टू डाई विद दोज काइंड हार्मफुल पेस्टिसाइड रेसिड्यू रादर देन गेटिंग dying by the BT brinjal there. Because BT brinjal will not have that kind of effect what a normal chemical pesticide has got. So I'm giving you both the sides. So when you write answer, you try to balance it out. So both the aspects are there. Now what comes second? See, this can be counteracted. But what is very, very important, you have to know the environmental impacts. There many of the arguments have come. Environmental impacts. Now tell me how the environmental impacts will be there. What all impacts are there on the environment? Right, first is that soil can be affected, soil and water. There can be effects on soil or water, such kind of things could be there. What is second here? When we say BT crops, all insects are not harmful. There are insects which are beneficial for agriculture. So let me write here. Beneficial insects like pollinators. For example, pollinators, honeybees, or you know that earthworms are affected. Right? Then what comes here? Next argument which comes, gene flow. Right? Let's say you have BT brinjal and cross with another brinjal variety. The flow of gene. So gene flow can result in lethal varieties there. It can make more lethal varieties if crossing is done there. You know that long way back to control mosquito, to control malaria, right? And malaria caused by female Anopheles mosquito. To control that mosquito, what was the thing done? DDT was used. But then what happened? Mosquito became tolerant, resistant to the DDT itself. So today we have BT brinjal or BT cotton. What if that pest or insect, they evolve? And those insect and pest, they become resistant to the BT protein. That can be possible long term. So here, pest tolerance here. Now D could be here. Insect or pest, tolerance or resistance to BT proteins. What is the fifth argument? Loss to biodiversity. Biodiversity loss. Biodiversity loss. Loss to biodiversity. the biodiversity loss can be there. How the biodiversity loss? Such kind of insects can be affected. Or I can say another thing, that if we only promote GM variety, we have so many type of native varieties, right? They will not be used. So what will happen? The other native varieties will suffer. That can be part of it, right? So there is such kind of arguments have been given. What is third argument? You are again aware, economic concern. What are economic concern? What are the points on the economic grounds? ऐसे ही इतने पिपली लाइव हो रहे हैं, हर साल इतने किसान आत्महत्या करते हैं, राइट? डू यू अंडरस्टैंड दैट? पिपली लाइव सुसाइड, फार्मर सुसाइड, आमिर खान मूवी देयर, पिपली लाइव देयर, दैट इज बेस्ड ऑन द सुसाइड, सुसाइड ऑफ फार्मर्स देयर. सो व्हाट आई एम राइटिंग हियर, इकोनॉमिक कंसर्न. व्हाट इज फर्स्ट आर्गुमेंट इकोनॉमिक कंसर्न? देयर इज समथिंग done by companies called Terminator technology, Terminator seeds make farmers dependent on seed companies, on GM seed companies like Monsanto's. Do you understand what I've said? Terminator, I am using the word Terminator seeds. If we use Terminator technology, now what is Terminator technology? Gene silencing. Silencing of the gene or DNA. What can happen there? The seeds will become infertile. You know, normal what farmers do? They grow the plant, they collect the seeds, and they use for the next season. But the seeds will become infertile because of technology. So what will happen there? Farmers have to buy seeds from that company, let's say Monsanto or Mahico, before every sowing season. It has to buy from there. So that will add cost to the agriculture. Farmers dependent. Big farmers may not get affected, but small farmers will be affected. So what can be next here? Increase in the cost to farmer. Increase in cost to agriculture. Right? And if the agriculture commodity or such kind of food becomes costly, so where it will go to the? It will transfer to consumers. We have to bear for that. Increase cost to agriculture. And that can result into more expensive. When input is costlier, more expensive there. So this kind of arguments have been given against the GM varieties. You can add more points. I have given few points of that, though there are other grounds of arguments also there. So what is very important? Biosafety evaluation. We need to first assess any kind of risk, any kind of safety aspect, then release into the market or release into the environment, agriculture. That is what is required. And environment ecology, you have studied that. So what is the name of the body which regulates such kind of GM varieties in India? There is a body there, no, which looks into such GM varieties, approval. And then only it can go to the market. So what is the name of that body? GESC. Under which ministry GESC works? Genetic engineering. Earlier it was approval committee, but now appraisal committee. Right? And it works within, let me write here, GM rules. GM rules 1989 under Environment Protection Act. It has been created under Environment Protection Act 1986. Genetic engineering appraisal committee. Earlier it was called approval committee. It has been formed under the GM rules 1989, notified under Environment Protection Act 1986. So the control lies with Environment Ministry, not Ministry of Agriculture, not Ministry of Science and Technology. Here the role of Environment Ministry comes. GESC is there, right? So GM mustard, you know that. GM mustard, GESC has been coming to that part. It can recommend whether to go for agriculture or not. Recommendation of that, right? Is it clear? So we have a regulatory body. Now tell me, which guidelines are followed by GESC? Which international guidelines is followed? Yes, you're right. Cartagena Protocol. So it's based on Cartagena Protocol on Biosafety. LMO part of that. Protocol on Biosafety. So what I've done in the class, see, what I taught right now, just to make you aware, you have to start from the concept. What is genetic engineering? What is recombinant DNA technology? how that manipulation can be carried in the lab, the basic biological aspect, then go to the application part, look into the positive side, negative side, then come to the regulatory side, how these things are happening in India, and link with the current aspect. So that has to be the approach of biotechnology, not simply just learning the technique. You link the technique with the application part. That's what I have done this exercise, taken it to all those areas there. Okay? So GESE under Cartagena protocol, which we are doing that. So that is what becomes very important. Now we'll take a break here. What I'll do is that I'm taking a break, but I'm playing a documentary also here. I'm playing important documentary on the biotechnology itself only. And meanwhile, you can, those who want to take a break, you can take there. But let me. Very important documentary is this, 1000 Genome Project.
Project is looking at the genomes of 2,500 people to find human genetic variation. This is places in the DNA where people differ from each other, and the goal of this is the data from this project will be used to find genes that affect disease.
I frequently think of 1,000 genomes as a Lewis and Clark expedition to the interior of the continent. We knew the outlines and the contours, we understood where the major rivers and the bays were. But what we're doing now is kind of systematically kind of walking through the interior into uncharted territory of rare variants.
The idea behind the 1000 Genomes Project is to build a map of human genetic variation down to frequencies of about 1% in most of the populations around the world.
Some genetic variation is very common, things like ADO blood type. The variants that contribute to that are in every population. If you look at any one population or any population, you'll find those genes. But some variants are much rarer or rare and found only in specific populations. So in order to get a good picture of human genetic variation, you have to look at a lot of people.
So the project actually oversaw the collection of what is now a collection of 2,500 individuals from 26 different population groups around the world, all with informed consent that allows this open sharing of data. And then the project has put together these sequencing methods and technologies with these DNA samples and is producing an unmatched catalog, at least to date, of genetic variation in human beings around the world.
We are building that catalog of what normal looks like, and so it's available for a lot of disease studies to use immediately.
The main findings were, first off, the amount of variation. There's 40 million variants in that paper, which is a very large number of variants across these 1,092 people.
The things I found most surprising were to do with the number of apparently bad mutations that we all carry. So, you know, there are these catalogs out there which try and list mutations that have been through clinical labs as being identified as pathogenic. We are all walking around with, you know, between 2 and 5 of these mutations, but most of us are apparently healthy.
The other thing that was found, and this is not unexpected, but this actually gave the details of that, is common variants, variants that are frequent in any one population, are frequent in all populations. Again, this reflects our common shared ancestry from Africa.
I think another really important finding is that these rarer variants, and these are the ones that we might think of as being more likely to cause more severe diseases, they're very structured geographically, which means that the rare variants that you find in the UK are different from what you find in Italy or Germany or the US. So there's quite strong geographical restriction of these very low frequency, possibly quite bad mutations. So that when you're looking at an individual who's got a disease, you really need to take into context their local genetic background, geographic ancestry, essentially, of these individuals.
And that has real implications for how you design disease studies, because a lot of people want to, say, to be efficient with money, and of course NIH appreciates that. A lot of people want to use a shared control group and then look at their disease study, their autism, the type 2 diabetes, arthritis, against a common disease group. But it turns out, because of this differentiation in rare variants, and because a lot of people nowadays are interested in understanding how rare variants contribute to disease, you can't take one population and study diabetes in it and a different population and use that as your control group, because those rare variants will result in a lot of false positives. You get wrong results if you do that. So that means you have to be very careful how you design your study so that you match your control group very carefully with your case group.
But actually, genetic variation in its own, on its own doesn't make a huge amount of sense. It's not wildly interesting. It only makes sense in the light of the phenotypes that we can collect, what people look like, what diseases they're going to get, how they respond to different drugs.
So there's a couple ways in which thousand genomes data are being used.
The data can be used to support studies of the genetic variants found in the Thousand Genomes Project for their role in disease.
So you look through the whole genome, you look for regions that differ in frequency between people with a disease, people without disease, and those are regions that you want to follow up on because they're quite likely to contain genes that will contribute to the disease risk.
In many of our diabetes studies, we've identified common genetic variants that are associated with risk of type 2 diabetes. There are actually now over 50 such regions of the human genome that have been identified as contributing somehow to diabetes risk. But in very few of these do we actually know the causal mutation in that gene region that is actually why or how that gene region contributes to disease. And because before the Thousand Genomes Project and other sequencing studies, we only had a partial list of the genetic variants in each of those regions, it was like trying to find the needle in a haystack without having the ability to see all the pieces of hay and the needle.
So what you can do is, instead of having to sequence all these people, you can look in the database and look at Thousand Genomes data and say, okay, in these regions, these are all the variants, almost all, as I say. It's not going to find every last one, but it's almost all the variation in that region, which means each study doesn't have to sequence its own people. It can just go to the computer and find most of the variation that's there.
But a colleague here who's interested in multiple sclerosis, he picked up on a gene that had been pulled out of genome-wide association study. He looked in the thousand genome data and found that there was a variant that seemed to be explaining most of the signal.
The thousand genomes data set for phase one is on the order of 180 terabytes. So that's 180,000 gigabytes. Remember, DVD is 4 gig, right? So take 180,000 and divide it by 4, and that's how many DVDs worth of data we have. It is by far the largest public bioinformatics data set in the world.
A number of different sequencing technology companies have been active participants in the project, and many different sequencing laboratories around the world have employed these different methods. And together, the project has worked to make it so that it's much more practical than it was to take data with one machine or one lab and make it compatible and comparable to data generated at a different time with a different machine in a different lab. That might sound very easy, but it turns out to be extremely difficult.
Once you take the raw sequence reads, you have to map them onto the genome, then have to call variants. Point places in the DNA where people differ, called SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms, are more or less easy to make calls on. Structural variants, where there's an insertion or a deletion, or a piece of the DNA is flipped over, a piece of DNA has moved over there, or it's been copied, copy number variants, those are actually much harder to deal with. And so there's a very active part of the analysis group talking about structural variants.
I think the Thousand Genome Project has been the driving project for working out how to sequence human genomes.
So an interesting thing about this project is that there's been huge numbers of analysts from a lot of institutions. Some of them have come from the sequencing centers, but many of them come from various other places in the US and Europe and China to work on these data. And so the group has an analysis group call every week. And so many, many people have been working very cooperatively to produce the data set.
Just within this last year, there have been over 5,000 institutions around the world, over 2,000 to the United States, and 3,000 everywhere else that have downloaded parts of 1,000, at least some part of 1,000 genomes. There are research universities and teaching hospitals that maintain copies of everything.
I think the legacy of these projects are numerous. One is that we will have succeeded, I think, in making sure that our shared genetic heritage and our ancestry and the DNA variants we carry are freely available for researchers to use to benefit patients around the world. There was a time 10 years ago, and there's always this tendency, where some said maybe we should patent all these and lock them up so we can individually profit from that. But we tend to think that these genetic variants belong to all of us. They're not inventions. They're simply things we carry, and they should be available.
I think when historians look back on the 1,000 Genomes Project, they'll see it primarily as a driver for turning the idea of whole genome sequencing for personal medical use into reality. It was the key defining moment in making that happen, because it's been a catalyst for getting the technology together, getting the resource together that can tell us what genetic variants are out there so that we can interpret those in random and specific individuals.
मैं ये कह रहा हूँ कि PT365 yesterday I started with the science and technology. So how many have gone through the topics there? नहीं देखा है? ओके, आज देख लेना. ठीक है, टुडे आई विल बी कवरिंग बायोटेक्नोलॉजी एरिया देयर, बट yesterday आई कवर्ड स्पेस टेक्नोलॉजीज. सो आई कवर्ड ISRO, इसरो टेक्नोलॉजीज एंड ऑल दिस वन. हाउ मेनी हैव यू रिव्यूड दैट इन द क्लासरूम? PT365 यू हैव सीन दैट? ओके, सो yesterday आई वेंट अप टू 9 o'clock. मुझे याद ही नहीं रहा कि समय 9 बज गया. 3.5 घंटे में पढ़ाता रहा, मतलब बाद में मुझे रियलाइज हुआ कि अरे मैं तो टाइम ज़्यादा ले रहा हूँ. मैं हाँ, तो वही स्टैमिना, यू नो, मैं राज नहीं बताऊँगा. राइट, एंड आई एम टीचिंग फ्रॉम द मॉर्निंग इटसेल्फ. आई एम हैविंग एवरी डे 10 hours क्लास कंटिन्यूसली, एंड फॉर 3 months आई एम हैविंग दिस काइंड ऑफ क्लास, एंड I'm going to have till 20th of May, continuous classes there, right? So I derive the stamina from you people there, because when the students are there, then the faculty also get encouraged, right? So let us understand here. See, this documentary is about 1,000 Genome Project, right? What you have seen that. Let me come to this part. What I want to bring about here, a very important part is that about a human genome project, you know, genome project and all. So since a genome project of any organism, whether human or any plant or any animal, DNA sequencing is carried out. And what scientists want to understand? Scientists want to understand the molecular basis of life, how that organism behaves, what are the genetic traits, characteristics. Now this particular documentary is about analyzing after human genome project is over. That means once scientists know how many DNA, how many nucleotide bases, how much DNA is, and what are the sequence of the DNA in a human being. Now what the project is being done, they are taking the samples from across the world and create the DNA map, sequencing the DNA from individuals and try to compare, what is called comparative genetics, comparison between different populations. So that is what, and you'll find at the end, bioinformatics. It uses bioinformatics computational tools to analyze such huge amount of data that comes. Now, the second technique which I'm coming across, very important one, cloning. Right. One term we have used is gene cloning, the making multiple copies of genes. But here the normal cloning, animal cloning. Now what happens in cloning there? Let's say one you know the Dolly ship in UK, 1996. Dr. Ian Wilmot, let me write here. He is the scientist who first time created first cloned mammal. Right. Then comes, I have already said in the classroom, Garima. That is by NDRI, National Dairy Research Institute. In Haryana, Garima has been made. So worldwide you'll find cloned animals are there. And now what is the basic aspect here? The technique here, cloning, even human clone can also be made. The main aspect is that it's based on what I'm writing here, the name of the technique, what is called somatic cell nuclear transfer technique. It's based on somatic cell nuclear transfer technique. Nuclear transfer technique. Biotechnology method which is used to create cloned animal, the name of this technique is called SCNT, somatic cell nuclear transfer technique. Now you have studied from biology that whether humans or animals, they contain two types of cells, that is the somatic and germ cell. Germ cells are reproductive cells, whereas the somatic cells are other body cells. Somatic cell differ from germ cell in context that any somatic cell, body cell contain all the chromosomes, right? Whereas the germ cell or reproductive cells contain half the number of chromosomes. That's why in fertilization, half and half chromosome mixed together to form total set of chromosome that comes in zygote, right? Now what is here? Each one of us in the classroom may have certain type of similarities with our parents from father and mother, but we'll never be 100% identical to any of our parents there. The reason is that we get a half chromosome from father, half number of chromosome from mother. But when it talk cloned, when we use our clone here means identical, it means all the chromosomes, all the features should be identical. So normal fertilization, reproduction based, there normal way it is not possible. But in the lab, we can create such kind of cloned individual where entire chromosomes are same. Genotype and phenotype, both are same. And that is where this technique comes, somatic cell nuclear transfer. Now let me write the name of the person there. This technique was first time in 70s demonstrated in tadpoles, frogs, by again UK scientist, Dr. John Gooden. He is said to be father of this technique there, Dr. John Gooden, in 60s, developed this method. But his experiment was based on tadpole, frog. He cloned frogs. Real aspect in terms of mammal comes to Ian Wilmot. That is where the contribution comes, right? Now what I'm coming across here, this is Dr. John Gooden. He got Nobel Prize. He was awarded Nobel Prize 2012 for this aspect there. So worldwide, if you say father of cloning, that is Dr. John Gooden. He worked in this method in the lab in 60s there, and he was recognized in 2012 with Nobel Prize in Medicine and Physiology. Many of the areas in biotechnology have got Nobel Prizes. Right, so the Nobel Prize was given there. Now what comes the technique, how it works there? Let's say, for example, now I'll first draw the diagram, okay, how the cloning can work there, then I'll come to the written part of it. Now let's look at here. Let's say, for example, Garima. Let's take example of Garima. Okay, how Garima was made. Right. So Garima was created within this technique. I'll take an example there and kisi ka naam hai Garima? This Garima is a female buffalo. Bhaisi hai bhaisi, right? Not human, right? Right, you know that buffalo. I'll show you the photograph also. How it looks like then. Right? So let's look at here. So Garima, Garima, let's say here. So, see here, Garima has given birth to Mahima, right? And Karishma also there. That is, so this is all, not Karina, Karishma has been there. Delma is also there. So all those are there. And again, maybe NDRI Santa is, can create more of that. Ma will be there, ending with Ma there. Right, so Garima, let's say, we want to create a copy of Garima. So what can be done here? From this particular animal, cell can be taken. Let's say this cell is there. Any kind, what I've said, somatic cell. So let's say, for example, we take a skin cell. Any kind of a somatic cell. Right. Now what I said, the somatic cell contains all the chromosome. Here, what is called diploid, 2N. Entire, because chromosome, you know, exists in pairs. Entire chromosomes are there. Right. Now let's say, for example, a female animal is taken. But this female has to be from same species. That means we cannot clone using cow or any other thing. We need to have buffalo only there. Now what is done? From the ovary here, ovary, egg cell. Right. So let's say, I'll use another color here. Let's say here, egg cell is there. Now egg cell, when you talk about egg cell or ovum, so egg cell contain only what? Half the number of chromosome. So what scientists do is that, remove this egg cell. Nucleus is removed. Right, nucleus is removed. Now resultant egg cell will be without nucleus, or you can say is a denucleated, egg cell. Without the nucleus. Right? Now what is done here? This one. This nucleus can be transferred. In the lab, we can take this nucleus and can transfer into the denucleated egg cell. So here, nuclear transfer technique comes. Again, remember that this technique has to be the back of the mind, right? UPSC will not ask you to write about the technique there. So this now this nucleus transferred. Now this egg cell, this egg cell, contain the nucleus from Garima. Garima nucleus is there. Now what will happen? Certain chemicals are added. Right, you can add certain type of chemicals in the lab. And this cell, this egg cell, will now divide, just like a zygote. You know, normal fertilization zygote is formed. So now this will divide like a zygote. Cell division will be there. And it forms something called blastocyst. The blastocyst is formed. And what we can see, what is blastocyst? Once a zygote formed, normal fertilization, when a zygote is formed in the human body, it divides very rapidly. And in few days it forms mass of cell, what is called blastocyst. Now this blastocyst can be put inside the uterus there. It can be transplanted. Transplanted into the uterus of the animal there. And what will happen there? The embryo will develop. The embryo will develop. And then birth. The birth given of that animal will be similar to Garima. Because what has been done in the lab, entire chromosome of Garima has become part of it there. So this nucleus of this animal, right, this female animal, which has its own chromosome, this is removed. So there is no part of this animal's chromosome here. All the chromosomes are coming from the Garima there. And then Garima, which will be cloned. Now this birth will be there. So when it gives the birth here, so that will be the birth of Garima. Cloned animal will be similar to Garima there. Will have all the chromosomes. So we can do this with humans also. We can carry out such manipulation with human beings also. So you can clone yourself also, the same method. You can take a female there, from her ovary, take an egg cell, then add, take your own body cell, remove that nucleus, add that nucleus into that, and then allow the cell to grow like a blastocyst, and then add into a uterus, and then birth will be similar to that. That can be possible. Right, that is what is the technique comes in. Now, human cloning is banned on ethical grounds. Right? That's what human beings, we do not try. We try with animals there. But for humans also, we can clone. We can carry out the cloning there. Right? Now you can write there. About cloning, you can write. I'll just give you a paragraph there. This diagram, what I've explained here. Then I'll come to the application part. What are the positive side, negative side? We'll be getting into that one. Now we can write this. A cloned, you can draw the diagram, then you can write this. Right, in biology, comma, a clone is an individual. A clone is an individual which is similar to a single parent. Clone is an individual which is similar to a single parent. Similar to a single parent. Now you will first stop there. There are two types of cloning. There are two types of cloning. Dash. Number one. Reproductive cloning and therapeutic cloning. Reproductive cloning and therapeutic cloning. You have first of there. Animal clones are created by reproductive cloning using somatic cell nuclear transfer technique. Somatic cell nuclear transfer technique. Give a stop there. Somatic cell nuclear transfer technique. Now right, in this method, a normal body cell is obtained from the donor animal. A normal body cell is obtained from the donor animal for which clone has to be created. Now you'll first stop there. Egg cell or ovum taken from a female animal is cultured in the lab and nucleus of such egg cells are removed. Now bring it first up, are removed. using nucleus transfer technique, the nucleus of the donor cell is inserted into denucleated egg cell. You have to stop there. The resultant cell is allowed to divide like a zygote by chemical induction to form blastocyst. Now give first up. The blastocyst is transplanted into uterus of a female animal and female or animal, and the embryo is the and the embryo grows in that grows in the animal, and the embryo grows in the animal. Grows in the animal. Now, begin first of last sentence. The birth of the animal. The birth of the animal will be a clone. Or right, the birth of the animal is a clone of the donor of the donor animal. Clone of the donor animal. Clone of the donor animal. Right. Now going to be first of there. Now tell me what are the applications here, advantages. Then I'll come to negative side also there, disadvantages also. See, as I said, human cloning is banned on ethical ground. But animal cloning, which we are doing, where we are using that? Where animal clones are used? Mostly you'll find animal clones which comes into animal husbandry. You'll find in the, in terms of agriculture, if you talk about the application part, so mostly you'll find in the animal husbandry, where such kind of a, like you know that, like for example, just take an example, if you are going to crossbreed, right, if you are going to crossbreed or interbreed any animals, then the offspring may not have the same quality of the parents. It will lose that quality of during the breeding time. But you want that same hybrid, right, retained. So what is one way out? You clone that animal. Like for example, Murrah variety, right, high milk yielding variety. But normal breeding, the offspring may not have that kind of quality of giving, producing that kind of milk there, amount of milk. So what we can do, we can clone the same animal. So the same genetic trait is preserved. So mostly in animal husbandry, that is what tried out. What is second aspect is that de-extinction. That means we can bring the dead or extinct animals back to life, right? So second aspect where it comes is a de-extinction of species. And there is a one very ambitious project going on, what called revival of woolly mammoth. Mammoth, you know that, ice age. Woolly mammoth, which used to be part of the earth, then it became extinct. Harvard University is trying to again revive, bring back mammoth. And they are going to use tissue culture, CRISPR technology, CRISPR, and along with that cloning. But the problem is what? That's why I have not removed this photograph, this diagram here. You require a female animal, right? But mammoth is no more existing. Let's say we want to bring extinct species back to life. But you require egg also, no? You require egg cell. Right? You can get this kind of cell from the fossil. From fossil you can obtain the cell of that extinct animal or species there. But what is the problem? For after cloning this lab thing, you need a kind of ovary also, egg cell. You require a uterus also. Then only that extinct animal can be given birth to. So mammoth, if you talk about mammoth is not existing. There is no female mammoth. So what scientists are trying to do? They're trying to rebuild the chromosome with elephant. Because the elephant, as part of ancestry, has come from mammoth. So using elephant, now they're trying to clone mammoth. And if that happens, if that is successful, it will be a kind of a miracle. If you can make that extinct animal coming back to life, and in that case, elephant will be used to give birth to the cloned mammoth. This is what has been tried out. Harvard University is trying that experiment. So what is the importance of that project? Actually, the project is looking into adaptation of Asian elephant to tundra habitat. You know, tundra, where is tundra? Cold habitat. So there, how the Asian elephant is where tropical areas. How Asian elephant can adapt to the tundra environment, low temperature. For that, they are carrying out this particular type of woolly mammoth project. But actual objective is what? Actual objective is that not to revive dinosaur or mammoth and then put into the earth. That is not the objective. What you have seen in the movie like Jurassic Park, right? The objective is that those animals which have become extinct in near past, maybe let's say 50 years back or 100 years back or 10 years back, they can be brought back to life, right? Like I'll give you one example. Passenger pigeon, right, which was in Indonesia, now has become extinct. Dodo, Madagascar, Mauritius, they can be brought back to the life. So that is one objective is there. What is third objective here? using cloning, one can also conserve biodiversity conservation. How the biodiversity conservation will be there? Conservation of biodiversity. So let's say, for example, I am giving example, critically endangered species where number is falling very fast. Just take example, you know tiger there, but I'll give you the example of vulture. Just take example of vulture. So you know that in Haryana there is a vulture breeding center, Pinjor, Jatayu center is there. And four types of vultures in India has become critically endangered. Now what is the way out? One is through breeding. We can carry out the normal breeding of vultures. This is what has been tried out in Panjor. What is another method? Instead of doing breeding, we can clone the vulture. We can carry out the cloning of the gyps vultures and it can increase their numbers. Same thing can be done for tiger or lion or rhinos, there where the population is declining very fast. So that we can increase their numbers through the process of cloning. That is also one of the aspects there. But mostly, what I said, mostly happens in agriculture and those areas. Right? So you can write there, I'll give certain more points, right? Advantages, just give a heading, advantages. Now write point wise, number one, first one. To clone animals that can produce advantages, now write point wise, number one. To clone animals that can produce pharmacologically, pharmacologically, pharmacologically useful proteins, such as clotting factors, clotting, clotting factors. I'll repeat the sentence. To clone animals that can produce pharmacologically useful proteins such as clotting factors. That means, let's say we clone the animal and the animal can have the human clotting factors. You know, hemophilia, lack of protein, of clotting factors where the blood cannot clot. So we can make from there, right? Or let's say that cloned animal which has got that kind of trait, which has got some therapeutic protein, we can do through the cloning. Number second, to make animals with human disease and then test. To make animals with human disease and then test, T-E-S-T, test therapies. And test therapies. Very good example. You know, many times in the lab, transgenic mice. The mouse or mice which carries the human gene. And the human testing, what later on comes to human being clinical trials, we first carry out in such animals. To see that, let's say, for example, drug efficacy test. How the drug's effect is on the body of the humans, first we can test on the animals. And we can first make that animal which carry human kind of thing there. That can be also done. Now third point, right? To make superior animals of uniform quality. Uniform quality in large numbers. For example, dairy, D-A-R-I-R-Y, dairy industry. I said that milk, like Murra variety, dairy industry, we can increase that same variety there. Uniform traits will be there. Then fourth one, right? We can write this. I've already given, you have written this one. Okay, increase in number of threatened animals. Right. Now tell me disadvantages. What are disadvantages of this? Or any concern regarding the cloning? These are advantages I have given, where we can use cloning. So what are the negative side of this? That's the thing. Such kind of animals, it has been initially found not to live for a longer time. But then, now the technique has been improved where such animals survive for a longer duration. Why the, like Dolly died right? Dolly didn't survive for long. Actually, what we are doing, we are artificially doing this one, no? This is not a zygote. It's a normal, we made it a zygote. Actually, it is not a natural one. So there the cell dies very fast. Aging of cell happens very fast, right? So, but now things have changed. Like Garima in case, Garima is still surviving. This all problems have been taken care of. But what I want to say here is that, if you talk about here, what kind of negative side you can say? Degradation of genes, okay. But say main aspect is what? Ethical concern. What is ethical concern? Screening. What we are having very selective. Like selectiveness, selective thing in any case, whether human or animals, is not good thing in long run because we only want hybrid varieties. What about the other native varieties? So that will affect the biodiversity, you know. If you only clone hybrid varieties, let's say cattle, cows and buffaloes, but we don't give importance to the native varieties, so what will happen there? Those native varieties will suffer. So that is what we are doing. We are becoming very selective. We want this trait only. Right? Sometimes it can create social problem also there, societal problem. Right? Those kind of negative aspects are there. You can write the disadvantages. Just write, I'll give you point-wise there, disadvantages. Now you can write number one, propagation of disadvantages. Number one, propagation of few species of superior quality, few species of superior quality may eliminate, few species of superior quality may eliminate native varieties. Right, number two, second, in human cloning, social problems can occur. In human clonings, social problems can occur. Social problems can occur. And third, you can write, which is very simple, you know that. Costly method. You have to first carry out this one. Normal breeding is cheaper. So third one, you can write, expensive method. Right, it's not a routine kind of thing. Normal case, we cannot go for breeding, expensive method. Right, now let me come to this one. We don't have any law for this, but what I want to bring about here is that, acha, garima mein dikhata hun. Let's see the garima there. One garima is here also. Other garima. Kai baar naam Dolly bhi hota hai. Dolly bhi kai ladkiyon ka naam hota hai. In one of batch, not here, other institute, there was a girl who was named Dolly. And she was coming from Noida. So at that time, when I said Dolly, everybody started laughing. Same here also happened there. So garima, ab yahan koi aur garima khul jayegi. So let me write, cloned buffalo in India, NDRI, let's say NDRI and garima. That's more better there. Now images there. Lovely photograph, right? This is how it looks like. Acha, ye aur acha hai. This is garima. Right? Mujhe pata nahi chala janwaron mein kya clone kar raha, sab ek hi jaisa lagta hai. All animals look like alike, right? So isme koi khas hoga isme. Now look at here. Now this garima with again cloned, but garima has given birth to its own cloned animal. That is what you see in the Tribune Chandigarh. It is covered in that case. NDRI clone, endangered wild buffalo. That was the article given there. Right. This one. Clone buffalo there. Clone buffalo delivers calf at NDRI. Let me read what is given in this article. In what could be a first of its kind incident in the world of biotechnology, a cloned buffalo Garima II delivered a female calf at the NDRI in Karnal on Friday, named as Mahima. Right, this article is, date is not given. Mahima, the calf was born through the natural process and it weighed 32 kilograms. Mahima's mother was also stated to be a normal after giving birth there. That at that time, you can, there came in the newspaper there. So that's what we have been doing there. Now, about this Harvard University, Woolly Mammoth. Then we come to Woolly Mammoth project there. Revival of Woolly Mammoth. This has come in the current affair also there, but let me just take you to that particular part. In BBC and all, it has been covered there. Now here, the site will open up there, revive. I will also add one more aspect of there, this one, the revival store. So they have the plan for revival of other animals also there. This one, the project goal. Now what is said here? The ultimate goal, let me just scroll up. The ultimate goal of Woolly Mammoth Revival is to produce new mammoths that are capable of repopulating the vast tracts of tundra and boreal forests in Eurasia and North America. Right. The goal is not to make perfect copies of extinct woolly mammoths, but to focus on the mammoth adaptations needed for Asian elephants to live in the cold climates of tundra. So what they will do, they will use CRISPR technology and they'll combine the elephant chromosome with mammoth chromosome. And then they will clone elephant, and through that mammoth will be given birth. This is what Harvard University is trying to do that. But let me add here, you can see here, very clearly mentioned, see? Harvard Woolly Mammoth Revival Team has been working closely with Revive and Restore to study allele replacement CRISPR. The CRISPR word is given. CRISPR genome editing within elephant cells. Right, so this CRISPR is making news for the last two years, right? That can be a part of the question in the exam. It can be asked there. Now in terms of Indian aspect, one has said what NDRE Karnal, but let me go to the another very important one. There is something called Lacons, right? Remember this one, maybe it can be also part of the question, can be asked in the UPSC exam. Now Lacons is Laboratory for Conservation of Endangered Species in Hyderabad. Department of Biotechnology has given fund for making a lab for conservation of endangered species in India. And there, scientists are using different techniques. And one of the techniques could be cloning also there. This is the thing. CCMB, Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology. So in this year, what is the plan is there? Those type of threatened animals of India, like cheetah, pink-headed duck. The cheetah is extinct from India. So there in Indian scientists will also try to do the cloning and try to revive, bring back those extinct animals. And it's been done in Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, CCMB Center in Hyderabad. There we have this kind of project also. So one is learning the concept, but again, you have to link with the current aspect there and the government programs where you find such kind of developments there. Okay? So today's class, I have discussed about nuclear technology, application in nuclear areas, and then I have gone into the area of genetic engineering cloning. Now, tomorrow you don't have class, right? Tomorrow you don't have, no? I think maybe next week you will have class. So let me tell you what we'll learn in the classroom there. I will go to the area of DNA fingerprinting. We'll learn about hybridoma technology. All those techniques and technology part will be covering in the classroom. And then after that, I'll go to robotics, nanotechnology, ICT and computers. That's a total 10th class will be there. Two more classes will be there. And we'll end up with the new technology areas. ICT, communication technology, computing, nanotechnology, robotics, after completing the biotechnology part, right? So this will follow this. So we'll stop here the class, and then you follow with the whatever I have covered in the classroom there. Garima ka video next time I dikhunga. And okay, thank you everyone. We'll meet in the next class there.